How many people have your Bible tonight? If you do, stand up and raise it above your head. Bear witness of God's Word. Beautiful, beautiful. All right, we're going to be using this Bible tonight, not our cell phone. Amen. Now, if your Bible is on your cell phone, that's all good. That's all good if it's on your cell phone. But if you see the person beside of you playing games, you can stand up in the middle of the service and say, I cannot believe this person is disrespecting God like this. If you see them texting somebody, you can say the same thing, okay? Raise your hand first, and I'll recognize you, all right? Turn, if you will, to the book of Proverbs. Proverbs chapter 3. When you find your place, say, I have it. Thankful that the youth are in here tonight. We've been talking about, in a Bible study, about control. About the control that we think we have over our own life. And even though as Christians we say that we know that God is in control, still we like to have that control, don't we? And we have a hard time giving up that control. And yet we know that God somewhere, we see Him, this distant God that somewhere that's in control, and we recognize it when we're in here and something happens and we go all to pieces when we walk out of here and life happens and all of a sudden, what do we do? And a panic starts and we've just sat and said, we know that God's in control. So what happens to us? And so we've tried to explore this. And the last week that we were here, we learned basically the why. And I figured that it was a very good thing to learn why things happen that we don't understand. Why do these things happen that are out of our control? Why do these things happen when our plan changes or something happens that we don't want to happen or something that we would never expect to happen? And so the why part of that we learned, and basically we piled it all into several reasons. The first reason was, anybody remember? Because sometimes Satan interrupts our plan. Do you remember that? Sometimes Satan interrupts our plan. It's a temptation, but it's not an opportunity for us to fail. It's an opportunity for us to succeed. So God allows Satan to do it so that we can persevere through it. But sometimes Satan interrupts our plan. And then secondly, we learn that sometimes God wants to bless us with the unexpected, right? If you expected everything to happen that happens, then you would be God, wouldn't you? So God wants to bless us with the unexpected. He changes our plans so that something can happen that we can clearly see His sovereign power. We learned last week extensively about that. And then we also learned that sometimes our plans are changed. Sometimes things happen differently in our lives than we think they should, because God is causing them to happen in order to get us back into His will, back into His fellowship. And this is taboo today. This is not going to be taught in churches, because you might offend somebody. If you're to come in here on a Wednesday night and you're to say, well, hey, all these things are happening in my life. Well, here's a suggestion. Maybe it's happening because God is trying to get your attention and get you back in His will. Well, does that hurt your feelings? Sometimes it hurts our feelings. It offends us if we think something could be happening because we're not where we need to be with God, but it's a time of humbling. It's a time where we need to be able to see Him. Now, just as a truth, because young people aren't going to be told this as much. In the ministry that goes out to them and in the different conferences they go to, a lot of times this isn't going to be told to them in that way. I would like for you to look at all the older people. How many people in here know beyond a shadow of a doubt that there have been things in your life that happened where your plans were upside down, or unexpected things happened that brought you back to God? They had to happen as a disciplinary thing for you in order for you to get back to God. Your life had to go to pieces. Turn around and look at these adults, so that you can see. Do you see that? You need to bear witness of that, because sometimes God in His loving mercy will let our life go to pieces because we'll stay on that same track unless we see our need to come back to Him. Fourthly, sometimes our plans change or go differently than we think they should because God is sending us in a direction that we would not take if our plan worked out. Sometimes God has to redirect us. And if everything worked out, we're living a Christian life, and you know, these are the people that say, you know, I don't understand it. I've been faithful at church. I've been reading my Bible. I started Bible studying, and here, this happened. I can't believe this happened. Why in the world would this happen? Sometimes God changes our plan because He wants to send us in a direction that we wouldn't go if He didn't do it. Doesn't mean that you've done anything wrong. It's just God is directing our path. Now, why is this such an important section in our Bible study about being in control? Because knowing those reasons why, say it with me, why? Knowing the reasons why. You see, that's the first question we always ask, even if it isn't out loud, right? Why? Why does it have to happen? What do we expect? Do we expect for this booming voice to tell us? Or that God needs to be able to confide in us why He has done something? I guess I need to let Mike in on it, right? No. But we always ask why, don't we? Why did it have to happen this way? Understand that if you can grasp what the Bible study is and you learn on these reasons, it could be any of these reasons. It will keep us from being discouraged. Why? Because if we understand that something is happening, one of these four reasons, then we don't have to wait till after it happens to say, oh, that's why. You see, after it happens, that's when we look back and we say, man, I wish I knew then what I know now. God was really doing something. Why does that always happen after we go through something? You know why? Because during it, we keep asking why as if we need to know the reason. God is a sovereign God. He doesn't have to ask for our permission to direct our life. As a matter of fact, He created us and He has a perfect will. Whether we understand that will or not, it doesn't change His why, because His thoughts are higher than our thoughts. His ways are higher than our ways. We can't comprehend them. You say, but what about this particular thing? I can guarantee you God never made a mistake. And as you find out one day, if you will find out, you will be able to just say, oh, I never would have thought that, but that's the greatest thing that could have happened. Even if your mind can't comprehend it now. Why? Because He's God and we're not. And when you challenge that thought and say, but I just want to know why, then you're putting yourself at eye level with God. And you're being able to say, God, you owe me an explanation. And God doesn't owe us anything. And when you make that comment, you've actually removed yourself from the humble position that God wants you to be, and you've put yourself eye to eye to God. So why do we do this Bible study to where we find out about this? Because if you can grab a hold of those four reasons, then you don't have to wait till after it happens to praise Him. You can be able to say, God is handling the why right now. I don't know why, but He knows. Do I need to worry? Do I need to fear? Do I need to get mad? No. Disappointment? Disappointment's real. I don't know that you can change yourself from being disappointed if something doesn't happen that you want it to happen. But from disappointment, there doesn't have to be fear. There doesn't have to be anger. There doesn't have to be worry. The why is God's. So, if we can see that God is in control and always at work in our lives, then we'll consistently, constantly be that light. So, I want to start a new section, but I want to end with this one verse that we read, Psalms 121:3. I know I told you Proverbs. I'll just quote it. The Bible says, He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. God will never sleep on your life. We should all just stand up and shout. You know that? God will never sleep on your life. Have you ever been just tired? And you're just like, who just yawned and said that? Ron, was that you? Not that I'm calling you out, but yeah. Have you ever been just so tired that you said, I know I need to do it, but you know what? I got to get some sleep. You ever been there? God's never been there. This little thing needs to happen in Mike's life. This little thing needs to happen in Don's life, in Sharon's life, in Kim's life, in Terry's life, in Wayne's life. This little thing needs to happen in all their lives. Guess what? God doesn't need sleep. He never sleeps. And He'll never suffer. Listen, I will not suffer thy foot to be moved. That means He's got us. Glory to God. Now, we've answered a lot of questions, and one of the last ones we're going to answer tonight. After we've learned this and we've got this knowledge about who God is, we've got this knowledge about why these things happen, the next question is, what do we need to do when our plans change? This is the what. We learned the why. This is the what. What do we need to do when our plans change? Now, I know what all of us normally do. And I can tell you, as a pastor, I never would have been able to tell you this before, but the most common question, the question that I've heard the most in the last, years at this church and even before, in counseling with people where something has went wrong with their life, the question is this: what am I supposed to do? What do I do? Let me explain what's happened. What do I do? Can I set up an appointment? What do I do? We always want to know what to do. We get to a place and the bottom has fallen out. And what do they want to know? What to do? Parent, when that child has some kind of dilemma happen and you can read it on their face and they come to you, what is the question? What are they upset about? What do I do, right? We're looking for that answer, and God gives us that answer. But before I give you that answer, I want to quantify what I'm going to say. You see, so many times we look for the answer of what to do in a situation. When our plans change, that's the first thing that we want to know. What should we do now? What do we do now? Say it to the person beside of you. Now, let me ask you something. How many people have had the bottom fall out of one of your plans? That's your first thought. What am I going to do now? Right? What am I going to do now? There's a range of emotions that go with what am I going to do now, right? There's panic. There's fear. There's worry. And then there's the scramble. Anybody in here a scrambler? Well, here's what I'll do, and I'll do this. Well, no, maybe that won't work. And I'll think this to death. Well, I'm on the way here. I've done thought this, but if that doesn't work, I've got a plan A, I've got a plan B, I've got a plan C, I've got a plan D. I'm scrambling, right? And if that doesn't work, but here's what we have to do. Because I want to make it work. Any I want to make it work people in here? The answer for what to do is not something that happens after the plan changes. Get this. We want to know always when the bottom falls out of our life. We want to know when the plan changes, our life plan changes. That's after the fact. That's when we ask this question, right? What am I going to do? Do you know that God tells us not to ask the question then, to ask it now? Now hear me out. You see, here's a fact. Our plans are going to change. Amen? We are going to have things happen to us that we don't expect, and we're going to be in situations that we don't want to be in. If we look for the answer after, say that with me, one more time. If we look for the answer after we're dealing with something, then we're acting as if we expected everything to go the way that we thought it would, but now it hasn't. Oh no, what will I do? Now, the key is not to try to get the situation under control. The key is to recognize that it's under God's control. Hold that thought. The key is not to try to get your situation under control, but to recognize that it's under God's control. Now, we'll go on. You see, when we try to figure out what to do, there's usually some level of panic. Would you agree? And panic causes us to react quickly. That's what panic does. And I said quickly, not correctly. Panic usually causes us to act quickly, not correctly. Panic also causes us to move our mind to desperation or discouragement, because even though we may come up with a solution to our problem, we actually really don't know if it will help to make it better. Have you ever come up with that plan and you thought, that's what I'm going to do? And you felt that encouraging feeling, here's what I'll do to work it out. But deep down, you know that might not work too. You see, panic causes us to do things quickly. When we try to figure out what to do and have some level of panic, we do begin to scramble for the best possible solution. Now, here's what I want to tell you about scrambling. First of all, I need to see if I'm worshiping tonight with any scramblers. If you're a scrambler, you want to fix it, man, you're coming up with ways, and I'll try this, and hey, I'm going to get, man, you're trying to fix it. You're a scrambler. I want to see your hand. Bear witness, you're a scrambler. Yeah. Hey, scramblers, there is never any confidence in scrambling. Now think about all those times you were scrambling. How confident were you? If you don't have confidence, you don't have peace. Right? So you still panic. Because you really don't know when the bottom will fall out of this. There's no confidence in scrambling. And we tend to be scramblers. We base it on our intellect we may have. I'll figure out a way. Or we base it on our capabilities. Well, I can do this or I can do this. Or we base it on our means. Well, I can fix this. I'll either buy my way out of it or borrow my way out of it or I'll work my way out of it or I'll talk to this. And so we have this way, right? It's scrambling. There's no confidence in that. So there's no peace in that. That is not the answer for what to do when your plans change. So understand what I'm saying or what I'm trying to say. Trying to figure out what to do after the situations of our life happen is not the best way to have your problem resolved or to keep from worry or to keep from being discouraged. God tells us what to do, but what He tells us to do is something that you don't have to wait to do. Did you hear that? God tells us what to do in His Word, but it's something that you don't have to wait to do. Listen, here's what I'm going to tell you. There's somebody in this room, there's somebody on this front row, on this third row, on this fifth row, on this seventh row, I could go. There's somebody on that row that will face a situation where their life plan will change, something will happen that they didn't expect. Now, what do you do when it happens? I can tell you something. Listen, you can fix it tonight. It's going to happen next year. The Lord doesn't come back, you can fix it tonight. Anybody interested? Amen. You see, God tells us that you can fix the what to do, not after, but now. I hope you're intrigued. You see, God actually wants us to know what to do and do it knowing that everything in our life is not going to work out the way we think. So you were pretty good in admitting that everything's not going to work out the way that you think. So, well, here we go. What does He want us to do? I want to make it simple so that we can understand it and have a good takeaway. There is one thing that God wants you to do so that you can handle the what to do. God wants you to trust Him. What are you trusting? You're trusting His control. Now, I could just shut my Bible and stop there tonight, but I want to give you proof of the Word. I want to give you what He says, because I think we really look at ourselves as people who love the Lord. We recognize what He's done. We're completely devoted to Him. I mean, after all, tonight, you're at Wednesday night service. I can't say enough how much I appreciate you being at Wednesday night service. You know, as a pastor, when you look out and you see the flock on Wednesday night and you see the house of God full and you see youth and you see young people and you see middle-aged people and you see seasoned people, then And you think to yourself, you could be anywhere. You could use the same excuse that the person that should be beside of you is using. But you didn't. You're here. So, hey, you're right on track with God. Do you realize you could be right here tonight? You could be reading your Bible every day. You could take your time to pray. You could teach Sunday school. You could be involved in the choir. You could be a deacon. You could be a trustee. You could serve on the children's, on the youth. You could do anything. And do you know that you still could have an issue trusting God? Do you realize that that one issue is what turned me around like a bull with a ring in his nose when I was preaching on trust about 12 years ago in a church. And I had a sermon that was on trust, and it was hard, and I was preaching hard. And do you realize I got 20 minutes into that sermon, and I realized, you hypocrite. You are telling them everything in the world they need to do about trusting me, and you don't trust me. Here I've given you all these things. You poor little farm boy that came out of somewhere, and I gave you a business and gave you something to where you're not wanting for anything, and you're so afraid to let your material possessions go and your income go that you won't surrender to me. You don't trust me. I was preaching, but he was preaching. You talk about feeling bad. I didn't even feel like I could look anybody in the eyes. They came by after the service. Why? Because I was so convicted. You know what? I didn't trust him. I was preaching and didn't trust him. So don't tell me that somebody else. I had studied. I was diligent visiting, but I didn't trust him the way I needed to trust him. Guys, do you realize the what to do is not something that happens after, it happens now. God wants you to trust him. When? You learn the why. This is the what, and the when is now. If you can trust him now, but I want us to be able to see, because you can leave here tonight and be able to use this. You see, he wants us to trust in his control, but he doesn't want us to start trusting him after we experience the problem or after we exhaust all of our efforts to try to fix what's gone wrong. He wants us to continually trust him. Number one, trust him when everything is going the way we want, when everything's going the way we think. Number two, trust him when we see that something may not go the way we want. And number three, trust him when we actually see that something has gone wrong according to our plan, has happened differently. He wants us to trust him at all those levels. He doesn't just want us to trust him after we see that we need to trust him. I don't know what I'm going to do. What am I going to do? That's our question, right? Why is it that it's then that we're willing to turn to him and trust him? Think about it. This became big as I was preparing because I thought about the million times that I've done that, right? Now, Lord, I know this is going on and this is going on and now this is happening. So, listen, I'm just going to trust you. Well, that's good. After that ulcer has started, and after you've scrambled your way to everywhere, and after you've sat here and you've lost sleep, and after you can't even remember how you got to the place you're driving because you ran over this problem, and after you've worried about it, and after you've been discouraged, and after you've done the old no, and you've panicked, and then you're like, God, I'm going to trust you. Right? As if God doesn't see us out there going all these other places before we came to him. Right? You know, then grace happens because he does take us back, like the prodigal. But do you know that he gives us the answer here to what to do so that we don't have to go through the panic, the fear, the worry? Is there anybody here that would like to stop going through the panic, the fear, the worry? Anybody? If you're a child of God and you know beyond a shadow of a doubt you've accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, I can tell you tonight, you don't have to. There will be occasional times of disappointment. It's in our nature when something doesn't go our way, but it doesn't have to turn to worry, it doesn't have to turn to fear, and it doesn't have to turn to discouragement. If you can trust in the Lord, not after, but perpetually. So, what God wants us to do is perpetually trust him. Now, you know, we threw out a multi-syllable word there, right? To perpetually trust him. Not just trust his control when we see that we've lost control. So let me give you a definition of perpetual. There used to be, and I have to say that I was a young age when I spied this word, because the city that I grew up in, or the town that we went to the city sometimes, we didn't call it city, we called it town, we're going to town. There was a bank in town called Perpetual Savings and Loan. perpetual. And it always is true. What do you mean perpetual savings and loans? So let me give you a definition of perpetual. Never ending or changing. A couple of synonyms that may go with that. Everlasting, never ending, permanent, constant. Another definition, perpetual. Occurring repeatedly, so frequent as to seem endless and uninterruptible. I like that. Uninterruptible, like that bank was saying. Put your money with us and it'll be constant, consistent, never ending, never interrupted, right? Do you know what God wants? Perpetual trust. Not so much, God, the bottom has fallen out of my life and I can't do anything else about it. I'm ready to trust you. The what to do is a perpetual trust that starts and then it develops and grows and grows. So, you see, what God wants us to do when our plans don't go the way that we want them to go and when something happens we don't want to happen is perpetually trust Him. He wants us to trust Him then, but He doesn't want us to start trusting Him then. There are people in many different situations, and if they come and receive counsel and the bottom has fallen out of their life, you might have been one of those persons. You know what I'm going to tell them? You need to trust God. You say, well, you're telling somebody to trust God after they fall. Exactly. He wants you to trust Him when it happens, but He doesn't want you to start trusting Him. If that is the time you start trusting, then it can grow into perpetual trust. It can grow into never-ending trust. Sometimes there has to be that thing that happens in your life where the bottom does fall out and you are that scrambler, you are that person, and that is when you start trusting Him. But it doesn't need to be a start trusting Him. When the problem is fixed, stop trusting Him. He wants perpetual trust. If it has to start at a low point in your life, or it can start at a high point in your life. Would you rather it start at a low point or a high point? Exactly. But we choose to start it at a low. He wants perpetual trust. He wants us to trust Him when the bottom falls out of our life, but He doesn't want us to start trusting Him then. So the answer doesn't come when you get this problem. Here's what I'll do. When I get this problem and life changes, I'll start trusting Him. That's not what He's saying. He's saying, I want you to start trusting me now because the problem's going to come. So I had you turn to Proverbs chapter 3, a familiar scripture. So familiar, so easy, but I want you to see some things about it that I think are to the point with the message. If you know the verse, you can say it with me, verse 5 and 6. Trust in the Lord with all thy heart. Lean not into thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct thy path. How many people memorize that? They know that, right? Do you realize He has four separate commands in this scripture? Let's look at the first one. First word, fifth verse. Somebody tell me the word. Again. The person beside of you? Other side of you? Trust, so that we can't be off track. Trust in your capabilities. Trust in your mind. Trust in your motor. Trust in your means. Trust in yourself. Trust in your intellect. No, trust in the Lord with all thy heart. Now, this is key. We'll pull out this word all. Trust, we know we've got it by now. He wants us to trust Him. Trust in the Lord with all thy heart. God doesn't want us to half-heartedly trust Him. He doesn't want a trust that's partial. For that matter, none of us do either. Let me see a married couple in here. Married couple that's willing to participate. Raise your hand, both of you. That's good. Ken and Linda. Ken, would you like for Linda to partially trust you? Okay, Linda, would you like for Ken to partially trust you? No. And then you could even take a younger relationship. I look down here, Alex, Abigail, would you like him to partially trust you? Would you like her to partially trust you? Two good friends in here. What's good friends? Jacob, is that you raising your hand? Jacob, Luke's your friend, right?
Yes, sir.
Right, you trust Luke?
Yes, sir.
How would you feel if Luke partially trusted you sometimes? Yeah, yeah. Thanks, Sawyer. How would you feel? How would you feel if Luke partially trusted you? Right. You want somebody to trust you, right? Not trust you sometimes. Well, trust you today, but not tomorrow. You see, that partial trust, that's what God's getting at here. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Now, God wants basically a commitment of trust. You see, when we look at how to please God and how we're going to be happy as children of God, understand that it's not by just going out and seeing how many scriptures we can memorize. It's not by just going out and doing the works. You know what our works are? To please the Father. God wants us to please Him. If I'm going out here and I'm giving to the needy because I think it's a good thing to do, and because I think that it'll make me look good. No, I need to do that because I want to please the Father. Not even because I'm just told to do it. I need to do it because I want to please the Father. What he is saying here is he says, I want a commitment of trust from you. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Take that verse along. Take that sentence along. If God is speaking to you individually, Gary Webb, I want a commitment of trust from you. If God is speaking to you one-on-one, could he phrase it any way besides Gary? I want you to trust me with all your heart, right? Pete, do you think he wants him to, you think he wants you to trust him with all your heart? He wants a commitment from you, right? What kind of commitment? Once a week?
Perpetual.
This is big, guys. In every one of these verses, I want to show you perpetual trust. And you can write out beside of Psalms 3, 5, and 6, perpetual trust. You see, a partial trusting is not perpetual because it could happen today and not happen again until the next bottom falls out. It could happen today and not happen again until next week. It could happen again. Perpetual, remember, that constant, never-ending, ongoing. Psalms 37, 5. You remember a couple of weeks ago, I had a sermon on this verse, and man, I tell you, I was dancing all around my office whenever this was happening, and I was in the Word, this one simple verse, commit thy way unto the Lord. Commit thy way. God wants a commitment from us. Do you know what his first commitment is? I want to commit that I'm going to serve on this committee. Wrong. I want a commitment that I'm going to sing in the choir. Wrong. What does he want a commitment of? He wants you to commit your way. Commit your way. I'm going to give my way to him. And then, look what it says. And trust also in him. And he shall bring it to pass. God doesn't want you to commit something you have before you commit your way to him. And your way is a way of trust. Now, think about Proverbs 16:3. Commit thy works unto the Lord, and thy thoughts shall be established. He wants a commitment from us. Our ways and our works, if you think about it, he wants us to commit to trust him on an everyday basis. He wants this perpetual trust, which is not a partial trust or a trust of convenience. He wants us to commit our way and commit our works. Now think about this. You can't actually trust with all your heart if you're only trusting God after something happens that is out of your control. That trust would be labeled a desperation trust. You think, well, you just sit around and think about this stuff? I guess, yeah, I don't know, but I was thinking about this. When someone comes to you when they're out of options and says, you're the only one that can help me now, does that person trust you with all their heart? They might tell you they do, but they don't. The trust that you're getting right then is desperation trust. It means, I can't trust anything else right now, so I'm coming to you. That's not a trust with all your heart. Don't confuse it as a trust with all your heart. There are many people that I've seen, and I've done the same thing, but something happens, and they come back, and they trust God, and they come back, and they're giving their life, and they're saying, okay, God, I'm going to get my life straight, and I trust you, and I'm going to put my life back into your hands, and I trust you with all my heart right now. It was a desperation trust, because when everything panned back out, it wasn't a trust with all your heart. They began to trust themselves again, right? Happened to me. Has it ever happened to you? He says, I want a perpetual trust. I want a trust that is not partial. I do want to reiterate, you can actually start trusting God when you have nowhere else to turn. And that trust can grow into perpetual trust, but he tells us to completely trust him before, during, and after something happens that we didn't expect. Number two. Now, this little verse here, lean not unto thine own understanding. Lean not. Leaning. We sing that song, leaning, don't we? Leaning, leaning, leaning. Now, I tell you, I guess I would have to use Don. Don, can I use you? You mind leaning against that pole right there? Yeah, lean against that pole. Don's leaning against the pole. All right. He's not leaning against the pole, so he was just leaning at the pole, but it wasn't really holding you up, right? Come right up here, Don. I want you to stand right here. Learn about leaning, right? Don, I want you to lean right up against me. Lean right up against me, right? Lean right up against me. All right? Now, Don. If I let you go, right? If I let you go, how you think you're going to do?
I'm going to fall.
You don't think? Look down, Don, and you'll be able to see it. Mm. I'm going to slowly let you go, Don. Don't you? All right? So I let Don go, right? Nothing devastating, right? He was leaning, and he was leaning in hard. Don, get back up right here. Right here. Don. All right. Don. I want you to keep your feet right here on that bottom step, right? And I want you to lean back, Don. I want you to lean so far back that your feet stay on that step. Don, are your feet on that step?
Yep.
All right. Don, are you completely leaning on me?
I am.
Completely. Then move your arms, Don. You're completely leaning on me.
Yep.
Are you holding yourself up at all?
Nope.
So if I were to fall, what would happen to you, Don?
I'm going with you.
Huh? Do y'all see how completely he's leaning? Can you see it? Lean not unto your own understanding. You know what he's telling you? He's telling you not to lean against him, not to lean into him, but completely lean on him. I want that picture to be in your mind. Thanks. I want that picture to be in your mind because when we think of leaning, you know what we think of? We think of propping ourselves up, right? That's leaning. I can recover from this fall. Could Don recover from that fall? Guess what God wants? God wants to be the one that's holding you up. If he sees that complete trust, hey, so he is leaning completely on me. When does he want it to happen? After my problem happens? No! He wants me to get up today and lean on him, but not lean to my own understanding. Now get this verse because we have to understand leaning. Lean not. After he says, trust me with all your heart. Lean not to your own understanding. Guess where we most typically lean? We lean on ourselves. We lean on our own understanding. We lean on our own capabilities. We lean on our own rationale. We lean on our own means to be able to cure the problem, don't we? Scramblers, don't we? And here's a command. Lean not to your own understanding. Notice this picture here. This is not a leaning just to prop you up. This is a total dependence on who you're leaning on to say you have to depend on what you're leaning on in order for survival. To lean against the post, you can recover. To lean into something, you can recover. To total lean for your survival, you say, well, God wants us to do that. That's what you're doing on yourself. That's what I've been doing on myself. And you know what God says? Don't lean on yourself for your survival. Well, let's look at our track record. Has anybody successfully accomplished and carried out every plan that they've set forth in here? Raise your hand if you have. No hands. God has. Right? And he says, lean not on your own understanding, but, you know, if you think about it, and I'm thinking about the picture here, we can't lean on ourselves. We can't lean on our capabilities, our intellect, our means to figure out a situation, take control. If you think about this, you can't lean on yourself. Right? Can't lean on yourself. Don, come here a second. Don, I want you to lean on yourself. Just stand right there in the middle of the floor. Lean on yourself. Go ahead. Lean on yourself, Don. Tell you what, why don't you, your arm is part of yourself. Lean on your arm. Lean on your arm. Go ahead, go on down and lean on it. Just lean on it, hold yourself up. Just that arm right there. Now, Don, do you have a right shoulder problem?
Nope.
All right, I want you to lean on yourself. All right, so God says, God says, lean not unto your own understanding, right? So what is he trying to tell us? He said, don't lean on yourself. It would be impossible for Don to continue to lean right there. And as I go to the next point, you'll... Don, you can't keep leaning on yourself, right? Thank you. You've been a good sport, Don. Yeah, yeah. How many people thought Don could sit there and lean on himself for the duration of the service? Nobody, right? Then why do we think we can lean on ourselves for the duration of life? Why? But don't we? Lean not to your own understanding. Next, number three, in all thy ways acknowledge him. Definition of acknowledge is to accept or recognize. To accept or recognize. In all thy ways acknowledge him. Get this, our ways are the way we think, the way we act, the way we talk, the way we live. Do you realize we need to recognize God and accept his control in all of our ways? Listen to what he says. Trust in the Lord with all thy heart. Lean not to thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him. Can I tell you what God is saying with this third line? You see, the second line said, do not lean on yourself. Lean not to your own understanding. Acknowledge God in all your ways. He's basically saying, lean on me. Jeremiah 17, verse 7 and 8. The Bible says, blessed is the man that trusteth in the Lord and whose hope the Lord is. For he shall be like a tree planted by the river, by the waters, and spreadeth out her roots by the river, and shall not see when heat cometh. But her leaf shall be green, and shall not be careful in the year of drought, neither shall cease from bearing fruit. Careful here meaning worry. You see here a picture of a tree that is planted by a river, in so much so that the roots of the tree are stretched out into the river so that the tree is strong. So let it get hot. It's got a natural water source. It's going to stay green. It's strong. It's by the river. They say a drought is coming. A drought is coming. What are we going to do? It doesn't concern me because I'm in a river. Is the tree worrying? No. You get what he's saying? Lean on me and you won't have the worry of the drought. You won't have that scrambling mode where you're trying to say, how is it going to happen? What should I do? What should I do? No, the tree never asked that question. Blessed is the man that trusteth in the Lord and whose hope is in the Lord. Blessed here is a word for happy, content, fulfilled. Blessed is the man that what? Trusteth in the Lord. You see, we get the picture of the tree in the river. That's the picture of us and God with our roots planted in Him. But then the rest of the verse says, whose hope is in the Lord. His hope, her hope, your hope, my hope, if I'm planted in God and I'm perpetually trusting Him, is the tree perpetually feeding from the river constantly? Is the tree perpetually putting roots down deeper to get more? Yes, it's an everyday thing. So the future dismay, the future drought, the future problem is not an issue. So worry is not an issue. Why? Because there's a perpetual trust that the tree has for the river. The hope of the tree is in the river. Praise God, He's the river of life. And so we see this picture here of perpetual trust once again played out. We see here perpetual trust in leaning on the Lord, acknowledging that He's in control and that He is our hope and everything, that we're dependent totally on Him. You see, it's the key. That acknowledging, that recognizing. You say, what do you mean? Well, let's think about us. Think about us. How do you deal with dilemma? What's your system? I've got this going on tomorrow. You see, your dilemma changes from this age to our age. It could be a dilemma with a friendship. It could be a dilemma with a social group, with a sports team, with homework, with school, with something that's going on, with acceptance. It's a dilemma. But a dilemma is a dilemma. How do you deal with it? You start thinking. You start trying to figure out what you're going to do. There becomes this discouragement sometimes if you can't get a plan that sets you right in what you need to do. Well, here's what he's saying. He's saying if you're perpetually acknowledging Him, perpetually trusting Him, think about it, recognize. Accepting Him and recognizing. Now, Don, I used you for a couple of examples, right? So, if I were to be in a situation to where you knew you had to lean, and you were up here and I stood right over there and you never accepted that I could help you, never recognized that I could help you, there's no way that you could lean. You would have to carry all your stuff, right? But once I've helped you before, if you had to stand on that rung of the step right there and lean back, is there somebody else in here that you think could hold you up just as good? No. So who would you ask?
You.
Why?
You've done it before.
Exactly. You get where I'm coming from. You don't want to try Sawyer?
I like Sawyer.
Right. Right. What about Ethan? You want to try Ethan?
Probably not.
Okay. Well, why is it that you'd want to? Right, but, and so if I'm near, what would you do? You recognize that I'm here. You recognize, you acknowledge. In all thy ways, acknowledge him in the way you live, in the way you talk, in the way you walk, in the way that you think, you express yourself. Acknowledge him. Recognize God's in the house. God's in my life. God's right here. Here's where we fail, guys. It sounds so simple. In all thy ways, acknowledge him. How many of our ways and when do we acknowledge him? We acknowledge him after. You know what he's talking about? A perpetual recognizing that God is with us, that he is present, right? Psalms 46:1, God is our refuge and strength. Listen, a very present help in trouble. You know what he's trying to tell us? He's trying to tell us again, he never slumbers, he never sleeps. He said in Psalms 46:1, I'm a very present help in trouble. That means you don't have to look for me. You know what he wants to do? He wants to be recognized, acknowledged, not after it happens, but God, I'm going to start my day. I'm going to walk with you. I'm going to lean on you. I'm going to acknowledge you. And no matter what happens today, God, I know you're in control. Listen, I trust you with all my heart. I'm going to lean on you. I'm not going to lean on myself today. I'm going to trust you and acknowledge you. And all of this is going to be perpetual. I'm not going to start it after my plan runs out. I'm going to trust you today for those things I know I'm going to face next year. You say, well, I'm facing them right now. Then start trusting him right now, and it will grow into a perpetual, all your heart thing. But it will be up to you, listen, be up to you to acknowledge him every day. You see, sometimes we get to trust him with all our heart, and you got to lean on him, don't lean on yourself. But do you know that can go away next week if you don't acknowledge him every day between now and then in some kind of way? Let me ask you, you super faithful, you people that are here when the door is open, you people that are always willing to serve. If you stop having that relationship where you talk to him every day, do you stay super faithful? Have you ever drifted away because you stopped acknowledging him in your ways? Yeah, me too. So he gave us those three things. And basically, God wants us to always acknowledge that he's always there. And this kind of dependence on leaning on the Lord because we trust him with all our heart, it will basically keep us from worry. We worry a lot about the drought, don't we? We worry, what if this happens? Somebody that's leaning on the Lord, trusting with all their heart, acknowledge him in all their ways, they're not worrying about the drought. If we acknowledge or recognize that God's in control on an everyday basis, you're not going to worry. And then number four, listen to the promise at the end of verse 6. And he shall direct what? Thy path. If we trust in the Lord with all of our heart, not partial, and if we stop leaning on ourselves, if we stop leaning on our control, stop leaning on our own intellect, leaning on our own means, and we acknowledge God's sovereign power and control over whatever is going on in our lives, remember, we have to recognize God's always there and that he is in complete control, then he will direct our path. Glory to God, glory to God. So simple in these four sentences, right? But you know what he's talking about? Somebody tell me. He's talking about perpetual trust. You see, this line, he will direct our path. You realize we need direction? The person that doesn't think they need direction, the Bible says they need to take heed lest they fall. Because that person becomes proud and confident in themselves. And that person will start leaning on themselves. And Don proved to you, a person can only lean so much upon themselves, and then they're going to what? You know what we need in our life? Direction. Direction. You can't direct your life. I can't direct my life. A director, what does a director do? They plan it out. They make sure that everything's in place. That's exactly what God's doing. And yet sometimes we step in and say, God, I have this. God wants us to wake up every day and approach our life with the very real, recognizable presence of Him that says, I'm going to lean on you and I'm going to trust you with everything that happens today. I don't know that I'll face anything, or you might be saying, I know what I'm going to face today and I don't have an answer, but no matter what situation you're in, He wants you to perpetually trust Him. And His promise to you is, if you'll do this, do you know that you don't have to have the money to get yourself out of the financial situation you're in? You don't need to have the words to get yourself out of another situation you've got in. You don't have to have the relationship skills to get you out of the relationship problem that you're in. All you have to do is be able to trust the Lord. And guess what He says? I'll direct your path. Does that sound appealing to anybody? What do we always look for? Our way that we're going to get out of it. We lean on our own understanding. What a promise. Mike, I'll direct your life. Well, let's see. Let's consider that. Would you rather direct your life and the outcome, or have the one that created you, the one that loves you, the one that wants to prosper you, the one that knows the future and can control everything and plan and everything that's going to happen? Would you rather have that person directing you, or would you rather direct yourself? It's a no-brainer, isn't it? He said He would direct your path. If we trust in Him with all of our hearts, if we lean on Him and not ourselves, if we constantly acknowledge who He is and His presence with us and His ability to be in control. What should we do if our plans change? What should we do? What should we do? That was the question tonight. What should I do? Trust God. Perpetually trust God. When I throw that one word in there tonight, it's completely different than the 100 other times that you've heard trust God, right? I can trust God and go out of here and develop my own way. But there's only one way to perpetually trust God, right? That's every day. That's consistently. That's all He wants. He wants us to love Him. He wants us to trust Him. And He wants us to live every day doing both of those things. Let me ask you, tonight, that's the what. You've learned the why. So, would you say that you've committed to trust God? Is there a commitment in place? You say, I did that when I'm saved, when I got saved. Me too. I didn't carry mine out because I didn't perpetually trust Him. I trusted Him when it was convenient. How about you? Where are you at right now in your trust for Him? Would you say, or would God say, that right now you're in a position to where He would definitely say you are perpetually trusting in Him right now? Maybe your life is going fine and you're perpetually trusting Him. Maybe you can see something that's coming that's going to be an issue and you're perpetually trusting. Or maybe the bottom is falling out right now and you're hanging on and you're just trusting in Him. Where are you at? You say, I'm in one of those situations, but, you know, usually I pick that trust back up. You know what God wants? A commitment of trust. Tonight, I realize on a Wednesday night, the majority of people that I'm speaking to are going to be saved people. It's a Bible study. There may be somebody here that's lost. The first thing that God requires of you, if you want to come to Him, is the trust that He's telling the truth, that He loves you, that He sent His Son Jesus Christ to die for you. That's the first way you establish a love relationship with God, is to trust Him, and then it grows from there. But Christian, we promised to trust Him. Remember that line? I trusted Jesus as my Savior. What did you trust? You trusted Him to save you? What else do you trust Him in? To keep you? Do you really? Is He directing your path? Tonight, look at your commitment to trust God. Do business with God tonight. during this invitation, make sure you can leave here saying beyond a shadow of a doubt, I know beyond a shadow of a doubt, I perpetually trust him every day. And if you can't, oh, cry out to him and tell him you see that you need to. Be able just to have a conversation with him. And if you're that person that's living in that trust, you're not worrying about anything, you know that God's got everything under control, and you're living in that peace, then just come and praise him tonight. Come and talk to him and praise him. Let's pray together. Father God, I love you and I praise you. I thank you for who you are. I thank you, Lord, for speaking to us tonight. I thank you for your message, Lord. I thank you, God, for allowing us to trust in you. Thank you, Lord, for letting us lean on you. And Lord, we're just a mess. We've got so many things that we go off track doing, but Lord, you made us, you created us. So Lord, to be able to show us who we are in this word tonight, I pray, God, that this message is something that, Lord, people grab a hold of and they can leave that position of worry and fear and anger and impatience. And Lord, they can just trust you, not after something happens, but right now. Lord, as commitments of trust are made to you tonight, I pray, God, that you would overwhelm them with peace and let the Spirit be so full tonight. And Lord, if there's anyone here that's lost, I pray, God, that they would come and, Lord, have that initial trust, knowing that you love them. You sent Jesus Christ to save them. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Would you stand with me? Page 435.
I come.
I hope God spoke to you tonight through His Word. I hope that you can leave here tonight and know that, He was speaking to you. He was speaking to me. And this key thing in our life, you understand, if you can get this right, the whole course of your life will change. It's right there for us. So I praise Him for His Word. I praise Him for continually loving us and wanting us to be near Him. So look forward to seeing you guys this upcoming Sunday. Don't forget, Saturday morning, men, we'll be meeting here to pray. And don't forget Pray Rowan. Pray Rowan happens this week at Sacred Heart. The community is going to gather out there, and we're going to join hands. And, hey, listen, we're going to be able to present the gospel. We're going to be able to tell people that they need a Savior. We're going to be able to tell people that there's a God, but we're going to recognize Him and pray for the needs of our community. Please join us. 10 o'clock out there. They meet at a different place every month. So we appreciate them. Any announcements before we leave? I'm going to ask Alex to dismiss us in prayer. Thank you.